भक्ति सिद्धांत सरस्वती ठाकुर शिला प्रभुपाद की जय। अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय। नामाचार्य श्री हरिदास ठाकुर की जय। प्रेम से कहो श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्त वृंद की जय। श्री श्री राधा कृष्ण गोप गोपीनाथ श्याम कुंड राधा कुंड गिरि गोवर्धन की जय। गंगामय की जय, यमुनामय की जय, भक्ति देवी की जय, तुलसी देवी की जय, सामवेद भक्त वृंद की जय। All glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to the assembled devotees, all glories to Shri Guru and Shri Gauranga. So we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 12, chapter entitled Beyond Renunciation and Knowledge, Text 1 and 2. Text 1 is mentioned here. Please repeat after me. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Naradhayati Mam Yogo न संख्यम धर्म एवच न स्वाध्यायस्तपस्त्यागो नेष्टापूर्तम न दक्षिणा। श्री भगवान उवाच न राध्यपति माम योगो न सांख्यम धर्म एवच न स्वाध्यायस्तपस्त्यागो नेष्टापूर्तम न दक्षिणा। श्री भगवान उवाच नरोध्यपति नरोध्ययति माम योगो न सांख्यम धर्म एव च न स्वाध्यायस्तपस्त्यागो नेष्टापूर्तम न दक्षिणा। श्री भगवान उवाच असांख्यम धर्म एव च श्री भगवान उवाच नरोध्यपति माम योगो सांख्यम धर्म एव च असाध्यायस्तपस्त्यागो दक्षिणा। माताजी श्री भगवान उवाच नरोध्ययति माम योगो न सांख्यम धर्म एव च साध्यायस्तपस्त्यागो निष्ठापूर्तं न दक्षिणा। There's a second part which I will just read. Vratani yajas chandramsi तीर्थानि नियमायमा यथाद्वरुन्दे सत्संग सर्वसंगापहो किमाम। श्री भगवान उवाच द सुप्रीम पर्सनालिटी ऑफ गॉड हैड सेड न रोध्यति डज नॉट कंट्रोल माम मी योग द अष्टंग योग सिस्टम ordinary piety such as non-violence eva indeed cha also na neither swadhyaya chanting the vedas tapah penances tyaga the renounced order of life na nor ishtapurtam the performance of sacrifice and public welfare activities such as digging wells or planting trees no neither dakshina charity vratani taking vows such as fasting completely on ekadashi yagna worship of the demigods Chandamsi, chanting confidential mantras, Tirthani, going to holy places of pilgrimage, Niyama, following major instructions for spiritual discipline, Yama, and also minor regulations, Yatha, as Avarundhe, brings under control satsanga association with my devotees sarva all sanga material association apaha removing he certainly mam me translation and purport by the humble disciples of his divine grace AC Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada Translation, the Supreme Personality of Godhead said, My dear Uddhava, by associating with my pure devotees, one can destroy one's attachment for all objects of material sense gratification. Such purifying association brings me under the control of my devotee. One may perform the Ashtanga Yoga system, engage in philosophical analysis of the elements of material nature, practice non-violence and other ordinary principles of piety, chant the Vedas, perform penances, take to the renounced order of life, execute sacrificial performances and dig wells, plant trees and perform other public welfare activities, give in charity, carry out severe vows, worship the demigods, chant confidential mantras, visit holy places or accept major and minor disciplinary injunctions. But even by performing such activities, one does not bring me under his control. Purport with three parts to it, so I'm only supposed to read the last part. It's a very long purport. So we'll conclude the text with this purport. The principle of not giving up prescribed vows may be further illustrated by the example of Maharaj Amrish. In the ninth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, we find that although Maharaj Amrish performed elaborate Vedic sacrifices, his goal was always the satisfaction of the Lord. The citizens in his kingdom did not desire to go to heaven because they were always hearing about the glories of Vaikuntha. Amrish Maharaj, along with his queen, observed the vow of Ekadashi and Dwadashi for 1 year. Since Amrish Maharaj is considered to be a great jewel among Vaishnavas, and since his behavior was always exemplary, it is definitely concluded that such vows as fasting on Ekadashi are imperative for Vaishnavas. It is further stated in Vedic literature, if due to negligence a Vaishnav does not fast on Ekadashi, then his worship of Lord Vishnu is useless and he will go to hell. The members of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness fast from grains and beans on Ekadashi, and this vow should always be observed by all of its members. If one falsely thinks that one may obtain the association of Lord Krishna merely by great austerities, or brilliant studies in Sanskrit literature, or magnanimous acts of charity, etc., one's Krishna consciousness will be distorted and weakened. One should remember the example of Lord Chaitanya, who practiced Krishna consciousness by constantly hearing and chanting about Lord Krishna. If by fasting, study, austerity or sacrifice, one becomes more fit to participate in the Sankirtan movement of Lord Chaitanya, then such activities are also pleasing to Lord Krishna. But the Lord clearly explains here that such activities can never become central to in the practice of Bhakti Yoga. They must remain in an auxiliary relationship to the supreme process of satsanga or association with pure devotees who hear and chant the glories of the Lord. Srila Madhvacharya has quoted from Vedic literatures that if one offends the Lord's devotees and does not learn to associate with them, Lord Vishnu personally places barriers in the path of such a person so that he may not enter into the Lord's company. Om Ajnantimirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuran Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namah Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Shrimati Bhaktivedanta Swami Tinamine Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Prachayane Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschata Deshatayane. So here we see a very definitive and a very powerful statement in the purport and in the text both. So practically all kinds of sattvic activities have been enumerated and very, very specifically mentioned that they have a importance in our lives, but that they are auxiliary, that means they are not the central process of Bhakti Yoga. And the central process, as mentioned here, is the most important backbone of the spiritual efforts is the association of devotees, and we will discuss that a little bit today. See, it is generally seen, it is our human nature that we take great things we take cheaply and cheap things we take greatly. All things which are eternal, which we understand now through the process, we take it very lightly, and all things which are temporary, we put huge emphasis on that. So this is human nature, that's our basic challenge. And when things are easily accessible, then we don't often really see the value, because we take it for granted. This is also part of human nature. And therefore, when we talk of satsang association, that way you have association of members of for commercial activities. As Prabhupada said, there's an association of crows. They will come together. Anybody comes together, we call it association. So the word is very loosely used. But when we talk of satsanga, and in that, to understand why satsanga is valuable, we need to first understand what the shastras and what the great souls and what the Lord Himself say about one moment's association. First, let's understand what they say about one moment's association. And then we see the value of what satsang in on a regular basis in larger quantities would be. So there are innumerable instances of repeated mentions that even one moment's association of one moment, which is less than 1/12th of a second, one moment's association is greater than liberation or then to elevation to higher planets, etc. We will come to that aspect later, as to, since that statement may be bewildering, we will try to understand that though we take things on faith also, but nevertheless we'll come to that in a moment. But just if you stay with this, that one moment's association is considered to be more powerful, or more infinitely more powerful, in fact, than all the other things which we strive, most people would strive for, even pious people would be strive for. So, it's considered the highest benediction of for any human being. The very highest, which in the dialogue between Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Ramanand Rai, which is very definitive, where Ramanand Rai eventually, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu keeps probing him to get him to, for benefit of mankind, to say what is the most important, beyond everything else, he states that is the association of devotees. And why is it that? Because association of a pure devotee or an advanced devotee is like association of Krishna. Why? Because that pure devotee is only talking about the Lord, he's glorifying the Lord, Lord's pastimes, the Lord's activities constantly. So actually we get to know more about the Lord, because the Lord is very humble, he doesn't speak about himself. In the Bhagavad Gita he gives instructions, in the Bhagavatam we hear about his glories, and we hear about his glories through, some of them are his avatars, through the avatars, but some, many are through the great personalities, great rishis, who actually glorify the Lord. And then in our parampara, in the, through the acharyas, who follow the process and who are also giving us the same wisdom, they give us the same benefit, which is as good as hearing from Sukhdev Goswami, for instance, that we are hearing the highest, the glories of the Lord. So because they give this, the association of the sadhus give us this benefit of hearing constantly, and that is why Yudhishthira Maharaj said that all the holy pilgrimages of the entire world are in the pure, in the lotus feet of the pure devotee. All the, because they reside there because actually the Lord manifests himself in through the pure devotee. He actually comes in the hearts and the minds, and to us he, Krishna, comes through the pure devotee's heart, because he is constant. There is no difference between the holy name and the place. Therefore, all the therefore actually the body of a pure devotee is considered Vrindavan, because there is no difference between the place and the holy name. So these are the reasons why we hear what the why the benefits are of the highest, why it is considered. And you know, if you say that there is nothing higher, it's an absolute statement. It is not relative. Most things we say in relation to other things, but this is in complete. We say this: what is the most important thing in life? That association of devotees. Now, association doesn't necessarily mean physical only. Association can be through, in fact, it can be even deeper and intensified through service. And we'll talk about this concept of Vipralamba Seva a little later. But Krishna is always remembered by the pure devotee in his heart. And we have example. I mean, we are very fortunate in this yuga that we have a personal example of Srila Prabhupada, even though we may not have seen him, but he was there just like yesterday practically. And we have enough documentary evidence, enough books, and it, most important, enough of his disciples to tell us how one personality, how pure devotee actually, you know, if you say, if you want a laboratory, you have an example, a sample. Here you have one where over almost 100 years, from 1896 to 1977, how a perfect example of somebody who was only, from the beginning to end, thinking only of Krishna. Did all the activities thinking of Krishna, but doing it by again following a pure devotee, that is his Guru Maharaj Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur. So we are very fortunate there. So we should be very eager. That is a very important thing that we have to be, because eagerness is a very, and that enthusiasm is very essential for a bhakti yoga. So it is not like a passive intellectual exercise wherein we just absorb the knowledge, we agree mentally, yes, it's true. But if the eagerness is not there, then the impetus to act on it and really start to transform our lives would not be there. And really the benefit comes only when we act on it. Of course, we do get the benefit, the minute we have heard, the moment's association means that the process starts, but it can be, for, it, but then it could be many lifetimes. We do not know when that seed will fructify. But if we act on it, so therefore the eagerness and enthusiasm, which comes also not spontaneously, because we are not meant, that is why our process is a process which is on based on sadhana bhakti, because we have to, it is Kali Yuga, and we are on that platform where there's a lot of cloudy coverings on our intelligence and our hearts. So to purify that, we go through a process. So the ingredient needed is faith, but with that faith, the process works. And when that works, all we need to proactively bring in is the eagerness. That eagerness, the enthusiasm, which can be translated into action, because then we will be seeing the benefits, and the benefits come through actions. Now, if you come to this aspect of how Krishna is investing his mercy in that moment's association, when we say that one moment's association is greater than that is in one sense inexplicable. We'll never the mind and intelligence has so many limitations, it is so puny that it would be inconceivable by any by any stretch. But we can see effects that happens, because how it affects our lives, we may not be able to calculate and understand it in the way we are used to, that we have a hypothesis and then you have a conclusion. But Srila Prabhupada said that just by seeing great souls, so when we first we see, we hear from the sadhus, and then we see the effect, and we see the practicality, we see the truth of the, and then when you see it actually happen elsewhere, when Prabhupada himself would say that, just by seeing great souls, there is a great benefit. Now, he said this because it is the truth. But what we can see is that when in Prabhupada's own example, like there are many examples, when you just walk down the street and, there are people who were mesmerized or were actually fascinated, or somehow something came in their mind to go and talk to him. In fact, one of the earliest pioneers of our movement, Hayagriva Prabhu, if you read his book, how he gives a detailed description of how he met Prabhupada. So in 1966, he was among the first ones. So when Prabhupada was walking down the road, he even gives an example that there is this tunnel on one side and the river bank on the other side, and Prabhupada was walking, and behind Prabhupada was a garden, and then the iron wrought gates. So he was walking parallelly to him. So he was walking this side of the road, Howard Wheeler and the Hayagriva Prabhu, and Prabhupada was walking on the other side. And he was walking very, as he does, very distinguished gentleman with a stick held hand, head up. And something, he just looked, and he felt a strange attraction. He immediately crossed the road, and then, as they say, the rest is history. Talk to him. So something pulls in that, and that seed can fructify any time. So that seed also comes through the association of devotees. So then, so this benefit is there, as Prabhupada said, that it can come by just seeing the, even by seeing, and then what to speak of hearing, because then we meditate on it, ruminate on it, think about it, and if you are fortunate enough to actually have the physical association also, then that cements that deep, the initial inclination to understand. So when we have this, so you may say that millions of people have seen, say Srila Prabhupada or them, whoever, the great souls, and we don't see that transformation. Hundreds of millions may have seen perhaps. That is true, but we are only seeing from the now and instant and the physical part. We are seeing that because it's a childish way of saying that, well, I have seen this, so I must now show the, I need it now, like a child, I've done this, so now show me the result. What this process is not so gross. It's a very subtle process. The scriptures tell us that deep down inside, how the soul connects, and we have to see it from the soul, and we have very little understanding of how the soul works. Just like, I can give an analogy that, which is actually true, You know, when I understood this, when my father was departing, so through Dwarkadish Prabhu, he put us in touch with one of our devotee doctors. She is specialist in palliative care. You know, palliative care means for the terminally ill, those who don't have now time, they've got some time only left. So how to deal with it, etc. And it was an eye-opener. When she came over and told to us, she said, actually, sometimes you may see that, because my father was not in a physically active, he was not, he was almost like, not in a coma, but most of the time he was not responding as such. He said, we get so fooled by that, but actually the soul is vibrant and soul is very anxious, it's inside, it's very much eager to hear. So, of course, she gave us instructions, you know, that we should always go and, you know, pour our heart, speak, tell our gratitude, and then tell the soul, you know, you can go, there's no problem now, don't worry about this, leave, nothing of Krishna, etc. But the point is that there was a detailed explanation, but even from a scientific point of view, the fact that the soul, we are seeing the body and the body is just lying limp and we say, but actually the soul is very alive. It's actually eager, alive, fully conscious. So therefore, what thoughts, what words go into it, it becomes very important. So we get some glimpse of when we have this statement that moment's association with a pure devotee, with a sadhu, real sadhu, deep down inside at the soul level, the connection is made. And that's affecting the soul. And something's of greater value. So that journey happens which we are not able to perceive. And why is it so? Because it is actually, there is a connection straight away made to Krishna. The pure devotee is only a representative of Krishna. He's only a his only purpose is to do what Krishna wants. And as per the instruction of the parampara. So, because there is a direct transparency, that's why it's called a via media. So, because the connection is to Krishna and to pure devotional service, which is the highest goal of everything, that is why the moment's association, the process starts. Now, sometime when you crank the engine, you know, it takes time before you actually hear it, but somebody has started the process. You may press the switch and then it may take months, but there we are talking of maybe minutes or so. Seconds or minutes, but here we are talking it could be lifetimes before we actually see the result coming out. So we may not understand in our lifetimes, for many lifetimes, the person may not understand many lifetimes, but in future, guaranteed, if we see from the Shastras and from the great learned souls, that the connection has been made. And because the connection has been made, we can be clear that the connection, that connection is greater than liberation, you know, mystic powers, going to various high destinations, heavenly planets, etc. But it is inconceivable to the intelligence. So if we were to bank on a very limited source called our intelligence, intelligence of a human being, then it is actually a sign of unintelligence, really. As Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, lava matra sadhu sangha sarva siddhi hoy. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu emphasizes in Chaitanya Charitamrit that actually this connection, and that it is the conclusion of all the scriptures. So now Krishna himself saying this, in addition to what we hear in the Bhagavatam, even in the Bhagavatam, in the through the Prachetas, also we hear that how the moment's association is the most valuable thing. So there are many sources which these are the indications, and these are the not just indication but actual direct statements that come to us, and that which we need to meditate on. That just because we cannot intellectually understand, but then we have to have that faith based on the conclusions of all these. Sukhdev Goswami, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the Prachetas, and there are many others which we are not quoting today, but everyone has that consistent stand. And if we consider that all of them with merit have actually, and we've seen their life, then clearly there is something which need to think that what that means, and then how do I take benefit of that? And then, this is the faith that we can get from the words of the Lord and others who are talking about this. But through that faith, if the appreciation is born, that means we start appreciating the value of satsang. One is that we do it as a duty, we hear it and we attempt it, which is very good. And then gradually, if we are sincere, then we start appreciating the process and the value increases exponentially. So therefore, what I earlier said is that if we understand the value of a moment's association, even though we may not perceive it, how many minutes and seconds we have gone in a presence, and you know, we cannot, but at least it gives us that connection, it gives us that perspective that if one moment's association is having that benefit, and it would have started in me, it would have started in others, then how much more, how much grateful we should be, and how much more opportunity we have when we have a larger association. We have, you know, sometimes someone needs only one plate to eat, and then if he's given, you know, a billion thalis, you know, I mean, at least he can say that there is no shortage. That's the minimum he should say. So here we can say that there is the kind of opportunities we have are unlimited, but if we don't take that and if we push it out, then we are at a loss. So coming to this Vipralamba Seva concept, as we said that the which means that when we may say, okay, I missed, sometime feel that I didn't see Prabhupada, as an example. Maybe we didn't physically see him, but he's living through his books, his devotees, his instructions. So therefore we get inspired and we want to serve him, and then his representatives are there, and then we follow them. So that is how Vaishnavism really goes. That's how Bhakti Yoga actually flourishes, by the actions of devotees and by the preaching movement which is spread from generation to generation. So when that happens, then we continue serving, and that service in separation is the same as associating. It's better than associating physically, because this would be in a greater philosophical, for sure, because the physical presence may be limited. And we have many cases where devotees who have been very enthusiastic during the physical presence may not be so enthusiastic after the departure of the physical presence. Well, here, if it is done with conviction, with faith, and with appreciation, and with understanding that why we are doing, then it is eternal. We have that opportunity to make this eternal, wherein we continue service even in separation, and knowing fully well that that is associating with devotees. So if you're talking of the highest achievement of association of service, the highest can be achieved by doing the service in separation. But of course, the consciousness would determine how pure it is, because usually we have mixed motives, or we're doing it, but we also have many other thoughts, and it may not be the single-minded focus. But nevertheless, it has value, and with sincere process, it could gradually improve the process further. So it is the most priceless gift, because Krishna is revealing the supreme mercy. I would just like to quote 2-3 examples for this. Like we talked of Srila Prabhupada, but once when we were having the installation of our Ashtasakhis, I think that was the time when we had the head pujari of our temple, His Holiness Radhanath Maharaj calls Jananivas Prabhu, and as the head pujari, he and his brother Pankajangri Prabhu had come here that time. And when he was speaking about Jananivas Prabhu, it was a most memorable experience. And it is a classic case where we talk of service, we talk of Vipralamba Seva, we talk of dedication to a disciple, to a guru, that because most of us are familiar with this two great personalities, Jananivas Prabhu and Pankajangri Prabhu, that Prabhupada's disciples, they came to Mayapur in 1972 or 73, and then for the last 45 years they have been serving there. And not only that, but till recently, till the first 40 years, they have not even left Mayapur. They have not even gone to Kolkata, which is 3 hours away, for 40 years. Because, and if you see what has happened in 40 years, I mean, they didn't even know that the communist government came in 77, then it was overthrown, then new governments come, nothing. They are in Mayapur. Of course, they would have heard about it, but I'm just making a point that they were not concerned. Certainly, what was happening in England, where they came from, or rest of the world, there was no concern. Also, there were so many floods, there were diseases, there were political fights, there were issues, there were so many things, there were challenges, internal movement, external movement, outside the movement. The steadiness that they showed, and when Radhanath Maharaj was talking about them, that and those who know them clearly know what I'm saying, that how is the attitude has been totally steady, only in the service of the deities and the Vaishnavas, in Mayapur Dham. So it is one of the, and they're still there. So really we have live examples of, if they have benefited so much, then we get the association, then it is like associating with the sadhus. It is association with sadhus. So that is where, but that is not just, okay, I want to go and I just autograph and I want to see, then I go back. You know, then we have our own selfish desires. It is like, what do we do to our admiration, appreciation, how does it translate into, what do I, somehow maybe it will rub out on me. I recognize my weak qualities when I talk to them, and I understand how, either we get direct advice, or at least just by seeing the example, you know, it gives us the impetus to improve. That's how association works. So many things are unspoken. In fact, most things happen which are not really spoken. The speaking, the philosophy binds our conviction, but the examples really play a massive role. Live examples play a massive role. One person can transform millions of lives. So Srila Prabhupada has come and gone physically, but you know, his disciples, when they come, and all over the world when they go, people are, so a person from the outside may think this is fanaticism. This is when they see them, you know, prostrate themselves in front of them, and they see, of course, there have been abuses and misuses also by others. But an intelligent person knows that that happens everywhere. But then when we see that there is merit in seeing that, if we say that all the holy pilgrimages of all the world reside in the feet of a pure devotee, in the lotus feet of a pure devotee, then and then when we go to Ganga separately and we pay obeisances, we go to Jamuna, pay obeisances, but if you pay obeisance to the lotus feet of a pure devotee, you are getting all the pure all the pilgrimage sites at one time. So therefore, in the example of Pankaj Angir Prabhu and Jananivas Prabhu, this steadiness in service, through thick and thin, through challenges, difficulties, etc., so many things may have been, you know, personally also affected, but there was no trace of bitterness. So even the attitude has always been transcending above the problems that are there, and looking, focusing on the eternal aspect. When we, the greatest advantage of associating, like Prabhupada's vision, for instance, the Acharya's vision was always like Bhaktivedanta Thakur, when in 1896, the year that Prabhupada was born, we are talking of 122 years ago. In 1896, what was his vision? He said that someday, I predict that all over the world, in all the cities of the world, you know, the Russians, Americans, and Japanese, and Chinese, and Indians, all will come together and chant Jai Sachinandan Gaur Hari. 122 years ago. This was the vision that he had. Now, he was not fantasizing. He could see that it will happen someday. And then it will happen. So, and it is not a coincidence, he spoke in the year that Prabhupada was born. And then Prabhupada, so, in the lifetime of history, you know, 100 years is a moment. So then came the time Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was the coach, mentor, guide, guru, you know, brought Prabhupada. And Prabhupada, everything happened at a time. He gave the instructions. Prabhupada went in 67, and then we see how it happened. So if we, when we see this vision, we know that we have that great fortune of being associating with this movement, with this personalities. So then, like in the case of Jananivas Prabhu, we should transcend the, you know, the negatives. There will always be negatives. Like in a family, if you have in a very close family, say in an ideal family, husband, wife, children, of course they have deep love. But they also may have some arguments, they may have some weaknesses, they will be having problems, right? So do they live only on that? No, that is something which is something which over time will go away. So likewise here in the family of devotees, we see the focus has to be on the positives, on the larger aspects, rather than seeing that, you know, what is the very minor things, because that those are the signs of Maya which can actually bring us down. Now a little bit on the process that we know that, you know, this association plants the seed of bhakti. When we associate, we do not see it, but then that when we said moments association, and then it may be we are, even if we are not very you know, completely open and vibrant to absorb it, but we start, we may be curious, we may be just wanting to know, but with a healthy curiosity, not a negative curiosity, but healthy curiosity, and then something clicks, we may not even know that. So that is called planting the seed. And as you've seen that if you, there are many seeds which are underground, whether they're trees or, you know, or plants, flowers. Now you don't see that, you don't even know. It may take years, and then only when it comes to the surface, then you see that the, you know, the seed is fructifying, that there were seeds and that it started coming out. So same way here also, we do not see it with our eyes, but it may take years, it may take lifetimes also, but that seed that is planted starts coming up. And after some time when they start sprouting, and here in sprouting means that in a case of a devotee or in case of an ordinary person who has no spiritual interest, but he may have got some, he would have got some seed planted, and then opportunity comes and we say it is agya sukruti, that he has got some unintentional gains. But then it has come, it has sprouted, may have been in the 20 years ago or 200 years ago, or we don't know. That is, we have absolutely no understanding of the passage of time. But we know from fact that that seed has come up. When that seed has come, and then his that bhakti lata beej has come to the surface, then that person has been given the opportunity. He's doing some seva or the other somewhere. He's helped a person. He's not even knowing that this person is a devotee, but he does that. Sometimes he may know, he may not know, and then it starts. So we may, everything to us seems accidental, but it is not accidental. Actually, so therefore we see the causeless mercy, the need to please the sadhu is critical. Because only through that, Krishna is pleased when we go through the sadhus. So when we go through that, so what to speak of the unlimited millions of blessings that the parampara would be showering on devotees who are actually spreading this, knowing that how valuable the association is. So giving 500 million books or pieces of literature all over the world, 500 million pieces of literature over the last 50 years, ISKCON has distributed. Now, some may have thrown it, but someone may have picked up from there. Many have read it and kept it and put in their drawers or in their library. But who knows when that happens? But it will happen. For sure it will happen. Their spiritual life has begun. That statement is a fact. But you know, we are used to saying begun means, okay, I will see it if not today, tomorrow. If not tomorrow, day after. It is not like that. So we need not worry about that. We should be very satisfied knowing that somebody's spiritual life has begun because he made contact. So whether it's through books, whether they come to the temple here and, you know, Sankirtan Prabhu's wonderful reception that is there, or whether it is in Juhu or any temple in the world, when devotees go. And I know from my personal example that when I was just in that, you know, marginal potency stage where not in ISKCON, not outside ISKCON, you know, curiously going to temples, and I saw the kind of wonderful, giving prasad, devotees would come and give. Now we realize that benefit is incalculable. We should be so grateful that somebody took the trouble with no appreciation given, no reciprocation being there, but they have given that. And it is true for all of our lives that somebody has taken the trouble. And we may have walked into the temple, but somebody, because ultimately what has attracted us is some person. The temple, yes, but only the temple. We would not be coming every day unless we are, you know, we feel comfortable with the people around, etc. You know, devotees are serving here, very happy to come here and give prasad, to take devotees around. So whatever is happening, the Prabhupada set a system of how to bring. So all that is, no, what do they gain? The devotees are getting just the blessings of their spiritual master, and through that the parampara, and through that Krishna. And that blessings is really what protects their spiritual life. So we have a clue from that this Bhakti Lata Beej, we may not have an inclination of Krishna consciousness, or the person may have no inclination, does not matter, but the person's life has begun. And if there is an opportunity to cultivate it, or to protect it, to nurture it, we should do it. But sometimes it may not be, like for instance, it may be a family member who we are so excited about Radha Gopinath Mandir. But my son is not interested, or my daughter may not be interested, some family member may not be interested. So I may use my intelligence and somehow make that connection. But you can't force it. And we may try and try, but knowing that we should not, means that frustration may be there, saying that I wish it happens. But then how come we don't know how we got transformed now? So we expect now that I am transferred, everybody now, I am a tractor, so everybody must come tomorrow. It doesn't happen that way. But that doesn't mean we should not make the effort. So being satisfied by the effort and knowing confidently that the process has begun is really the way we live our lives. In short, whatever we do, it is that wherever we go, whatever we do, we have the opportunity to make that connection to someone. Even if that person recognizes us as part of Prabhupada or ISKCON, that is a start. And then maybe if the person is favorable and he takes prasad or he comes to a satsang program, if not a formal satsang program, you know, one of the indirect programs that we have where it is, direct Krishna consciousness may not be preached, but spiritual values may be brought in. There are so many ways that they get attracted, and we are seeing this happening. And that is something which is the most important in our life. Other things like our occupation, our family issues, financial needs, health, material, we have to do the best, but setbacks there should not deter us from recognizing, appreciating, and really, really pushing for our most important goal, which is what we have got, how do we give back? Knowing fully well that association is the be-all and end-all for devotees. When Prabhupada went to the West, and he initially, when all these new devotees had, they were not even devotees in that sense, and they were just curious, they were followers of Prabhupada. They were, and then in the first few years, those who came to him, and they asked Prabhupada, you know, this slowly started dawning on them. When it started dawning on people like Satsarup Maharaj and others who have been there over 50 years, that when they started dawning on them, the value of what they're getting. Initially, they saw an old man who was speaking Eastern philosophy, and they were happy to serve him because they just trusted him and they liked him. I mean, much of it was instinctive. They loved the prasad, and then they wanted to help him. Slowly, when they started understanding the philosophy and they understood, and then it slowly started dawning on them. And the dawn means you only get a glimpse of the whole day. It is not the 12 o'clock noon. It is just the morning, 5 o'clock, 5:30, initial tinge of rays. At that time, when they started getting the magnitude of what Prabhupada represents for them, they asked this question. Some of them asked Prabhupada, what was the qualification to receive that? And Prabhupada gave a very honest and a very humble reply. You have no qualification. I have made your qualification. And it was not an, it was a statement with a matter of fact and with deep humility. Prabhupada has made our qualification. So that means that we have nothing. We have, our benefit was that Bhaktilata Beej sprung up through the association of the devotees. And of course there is a factor of karma which has brought us to give us the opportunity. But it is credit to the devotees that we can't, it is not just that I get the association and then I go back and say, oh, my life done. It doesn't work that way. It is only the conception. It is only the beginning. After that, we have to, you know, nurture it. We have to encourage it, you know, protect it. Also, make choices constantly on so many things. We may have to accept some setbacks also. But overall, the process has to be forward. So that is the glory of all devotees who are struggling to that, and that struggle is really going to continue. It's never going to going to subside. So if you see from that point of view, when you talk of satsang, that way you see millions of Indians, hundreds of millions of Indians actually believe in it. They're in various satsang programs. They're very happy going all over. So they have the understanding, the concept. But then it's a matter of how many people get fooled or how many people are going to the they believe in a satsang, but then what is their motivation also? So many may be going with various motivations. So we have to question ourselves, what is my motivation? Why am I coming here? What am I gaining? It may not be financial, then is it that even in the society of devotees, family of devotees, I'm recognized, you know, I'm 25 years, so I'm now a senior, or is it that I get some prestige? So many things could be there. Or is it that, I get opportunities to talk or be, you know, recognized in larger groups, or I like to go because, you know, there may be 100 newcomers and then they see and the newcomers are always like this. So we don't know. We may not state it. We have to question our motive. So Indians in general have an advantage in one sense, but because if we do not just go beyond the feeling that, okay, I am very happy, I met a sadhu, touched his feet, my life is made. I had a dip in the Ganga, my life is made. I don't need to do anything else, I can continue sinning. If that is the attitude, Krishna is a bigger trickster and then we'll get what we deserve. But if we were to act on it, if we had to go beyond it, then that's something which is in our hands. So, therefore, for all of us, whatever levels of preaching we may do, or ultimately we may be preaching eloquently by giving out talks to various medical institutions or whatever, or whether we are helping others do it, or whether we are just trying to live a Krishna conscious life to the best of our ability in our homes with our families, whatever we do, ultimately it's a preaching movement. We may preach by example or by words. So knowing this, that value of satsang is so important. Genuine satsang, just connecting them. And in that, it's like running the 100 meters in 9 seconds. I made the connection, it's not my ability, but I've been used as an instrument. So sometimes we may get an opportunity, many times we don't get the opportunity, there are failures. But the effort should be in being satisfied in moving in that direction. And also, through the satsang, we do not know how much the Vaishnava prayers work for us. Actually, this will never be known to us. We never know, on an individual basis, how many devotees may have prayed. I mean, somebody must have, one, somebody or the other, who has interests of ours in heart and might have said a silent prayer or may have had good wishes to Krishna, we don't know. In Kaliya's story, we see that's a perfect example of how he was the king of all the snakes, and the snake family being very envious, basically. So he was also very envious. He didn't like anybody to come into that area, the lake. And he had actually done Vaishnava Aparad, because he had most snakes were at least respectful to Garuda, and Garuda being the carrier of Vishnu and being a large bird, the snakes were afraid and they gave respect. But Kaliya was so arrogant that he actually stole the property, and then he fought with Garuda. He lost, and then he had to come here, and then he committed further aparad by actually with his venomous poison. Although many birds died in Brajbhumi, animals also who drank the water died. So because of that, Krishna really taught him a lesson, and he danced on his hoods, smashed him completely, every hood at a time, vomit and blood was coming out. So he was practically on the verge of death. The only qualification he had was his wives were devotees, Nagpatnis were devotees, and their prayers actually saved him. So we do not know. So we don't bank on that, we don't bask in that, but we should know that when we can also pray for someone out of gratitude, because so many have done for us, we should be able to at least, whether it's for their health, whether it's ideally for their spiritual health, but even otherwise for their well-being, because if they're physically fit, then they can also do service. So primarily, this recognizing that this the power of prayer, sincere prayer, silent prayer, has also a lot. So when we talk of satsang, when we give this opportunity for associating, and when we strengthen the bonds of, when we cooperate together and move, then along with it comes this opportunity to pray, and also knowing that I don't need to know and find out who prayed, but I know for sure that people have prayed, and I don't know how much I've been protected in spite of all my weaknesses or sins, and somebody's prayers actually Krishna has recognized, and just like Kali had no qualification except his wife. And then at least the one thing was that he repeated his wife's prayers and spoke the same prayers very humbly, and that's how he transformed. So that's where the difference was. The same in Jagai Madhai's case, that they were very, very vicious, but then Lord Nityanand's prayers to Lord Chaitanya helped preserve him. It was no qualification in that sense to Jagai and Madhai, but then they took the benefit and moved forward. So, we'll pass the time. I just want to conclude by giving a very nice example which Avatar Leela Prabhu had given once in a talk on association devotees, and it is important for us that he gave the analogy of this animal porcupine. And this porcupine is an animal which is, it's not a huge animal like an elephant, but it's usually in cold climates, but its body is covered with spikes. and very sharp spikes. It can actually go through our skin completely. It's very, very, and they got literally thousands of spikes in our body. So, you know, if the body is this size, you can't even, you know, just like Bhishma Pitama's skin could not be seen when that many arrows were there. Same way here, I mean, every porcupine has got so many spikes that you cannot, it's full of spikes and very sharp ones. But then in the cold climate, what they do is that they come together for warmth. But when they come together for warmth, they huddle together, then the spikes poke each other. So it is very inconvenient, not only inconvenient, in fact, it's physically painful, and you know, it's also very bloody. So some of them move away. But when they move away, then they succumb to the cold and die. So ultimately, they have a choice. They have to die of cold, or they have to suffer and tolerate the pokes of the spikes. And still continue, and then they get the warmth. So we are in that same position, that we may be in a family of devotees, in a community, congregation. In our case, it's a Chopati congregation. Or it could be a family of home, husband, wife, children, etc. In a family, there's always going to be these opportunity or the occasions where there'll be many, many, you know, spikes coming, and in various forms. And we have the choice of whether we take that as a reason to move out or to criticize, find fault, and make that the dominant view of what is around us, and form a negative view, and then take that as a reason to move away from our initial Krishna conscious efforts, or we learn to tolerate with it, live with it, and see the greater value. So the greater value is the warmth that the porcupine gets. The greater value for being together here is the satsang, that we actually see the not only the philosophy, but the many, many role models, many people around us who are leading more sincere lives than us, more transparent and more satisfied. And especially for grihasthas like us, when we see that we have the tendency most of the time to, you know, our main struggle is that I need to do well in my occupation, and I need to also spend time in my spiritual life. So, and then therefore you really don't know how to balance and what. And then when we get caught up in our worldly duties, then we suddenly find that we're finding less time here. So when we see examples of people who either in grihastha life and certainly also in the renounced order, when they are actually leading a life where the attention focus is is number one on Krishna consciousness, and then they're learning to curb their means their tendencies to the strong desires for material needs. Then so we each one's needs may be different, so we have to see where, so we have a benefit of getting that. So if we see the larger benefit, then the small pinpricks and these spokes we have to learn to tolerate. And lastly, I would say that the scriptures are saying, tell us that association of the opposite sex is dangerous, means intimate association. You know, unless we have some service, it is, and then we do the needful minimum, but not that you, because it, for both, it is, that's the way our, the Kali Yuga is. So it says that association, deep intimate association is very dangerous. But even more dangerous is association of those people who are attached to that association opposite sex. So, like for instance, for the men, we may think I will not associate. But if you keep associating with people who are like-minded, I mean, who actually not only follow but are close, then actually we are, it's a losing battle for us. And likewise for women. So similarly, on a positive sense, you know, Srila Prabhupada says that association of devotees, association, those devotees who are more attached to Krishna is more important than association with Krishna. I mean, direct association of Krishna, because Krishna does not speak his glories, as we said, you know, he doesn't talk about his glories himself. He'll give instructions. But talking about his going through his devotees is much more important. So, going indirectly in that sense, but actually it's not indirectly, it is directly, but you can say through the transparent via media of a sadhu, is even more important. So I think I'll stop here, and don't have Hare Krishna. Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.